we're going to be hearing about risk management. Now, I've asked Frank Kinn to speak about this. And the reason we are very excited to have Frank is two reasons. One, he's a prior CISO. Two, he literally wrote the class at SANS on how to speak cybersecurity as a CISO to business leaders. This is going to be a high-level class about risk management. You're like, oh, God, how exciting can this be? Frank is going to teach you the very fundamentals of many of the topics covered today. He's going to teach you what is risk management, how to communicate to your leadership in risk management, why it's important. Once again, it comes to a common theme you've been hearing about throughout today. If all you're talking about to leadership is gamification and engagement, while that's important, you're just going to be perceived as being in the entertainment business. And it's really going to be hard to both get their support and credibility. However, if you start talking about in terms of risk management, and this builds on metrics and behaviors, if you can speak in the terms that Frank is now just about to present to you, a whole new world is going to open up to you. You are now speaking leadership's language. You are now aligning your program with their priorities. And you're going to get a whole lot more budget, a lot more credibility. And to be honest, this is how you go from security awareness officer to, if you want it, to becoming the chief information security officer. This will open so many doors for you in so many different ways. And like I said, the reason I'm so excited to have Frank join us is not only has he been a CISO and he's been in these situations, not only is he one of SANS' most senior instructors, but he has written several SANS courses on how to do what we have just been talking about all day long. So in just a moment, I'm going to turn it over to Frank. And like I said, though, if you're already experienced with this, head over to Track 2 and learn about security culture from Janam Budge. If you're not familiar with this, you're in for a treat because it's going to be a very simple, nice introduction to what this field is and why you should care. All right, I've been talking enough. Frank, enlighten us with your great expertise.
Hey, thanks so much. Hey, I realized that I didn't change my background from a prior meeting here, but we will just leave it the way that it is. Sorry about that, folks. So, hey, thanks so much for the kind introduction, Lance. Really appreciate it. Let's go ahead and dive right in here to understanding cybersecurity risk management. Now, as Lance mentioned, my name is Frank Kim. I've been teaching, writing courses with SANS for about 14 years now. I currently lead our cloud security curriculum and our cybersecurity leadership curriculum, of which this topic, as Lance was mentioning, is an important part. If you want to reach out, contact me at any time after this talk. During the talk, of course, you can feel free to go ahead and chime in with Slack, you know, throw those proverbial tomatoes, if you will. I am watching Slack here right at my eye line. So any comments that you post here, I will get to them pretty quickly. But after the fact, if you want to reach out and continue the conversation, feel free to email me, hit me up on social media, and so on. All right. With that being said, let's go ahead and dive right in. You know, we've got a summit full of security professionals, security awareness professionals, awareness officers, and so on. So the question that we always like to start with is, why? Why do we care? Why do you care? Why do you want to be here and listen to this specific talk? Now, certainly, we all want to make our organizations a little bit more secure. We all want to improve the state of our businesses. We all want to do the right thing. And one of the other reasons that many of us are here toiling away in our careers is that, yeah, well, we want to be more successful. And to be more successful, it's all about risk management. Now, I started my career over 20 years ago as an engineer, as a developer, building applications, building systems, and deploying fun and cool new technologies. Now, I would sit at my, for the first many years of my career, I would largely sit at my desk, sit at my cubicle on my own, and I was happy, right? Typing away, writing code, deploying various things. I was really focused on the technical layer of this leadership pyramid that we see here on the slide. But as I progressed in my career, I realized, you know what? It's not just about that technical foundation that is, yes, very useful to have in place. It's about, well, how do you lead and influence other people? And so I got a little bit more interested in technology leadership. But then from there, it was, okay, well, how do we take a step back and think about this as a program overall that ultimately at the top of this leadership pyramid is helping your organization achieve various business objectives, whether that might be a customer-focused mission, whether that might be a financially driven mission. Now, for us, for you as security awareness professionals, what does that mean? On the right-hand side here, in the lower right-hand corner, as Lance was just pointing out. Now, one of the fun things, one of the cool things that security awareness does is I liken it to the various technical activities that I was doing as an engineer at the very beginning of my career and throughout, doing things like marketing, effective communications, those edgy posters, fun memes, those engaging videos. We have to have all of those things, but as we progress, we want to make a little bit more of an impact. How do we do that? Well, security awareness, overall cybersecurity program, we need to understand what technology leadership cares about, aligning our work, your work in awareness, with those of the other larger security priorities, and ultimately gaining respect and credibility of the security team to ultimately, at the very top right-hand corner, gain leadership's overall support as well. So how do we go about doing this? As Lance said, what we're going to talk about is the very basic risk calculation here. And this serves as the foundation for everything that we do, not only in awareness, not only in cybersecurity, but a lot of what we do in our day-to-day living here. And a reminder, what is risk? Well, really, risk is just probability times impact, right? Impact, what is the bad thing that can occur? Probability, what is the likelihood that that is going to happen? It is the combination of both of those things that where we want to try to better understand risk for ourselves, risk for our organizations. Now, I'm going to switch to the next slide here momentarily. And this next slide is just an image that is the best graphic that I have seen depicting, explaining in simple terms what risk actually is. And if some of you may have seen this online, this was making the rounds on Twitter, social media, not too long ago. If we take a look at this at the very top, you've got somebody that is looking to get from point A to point B, but they want to do it without getting wet, without getting hurt. Well, at the very top, you've got high probability that they're going to get wet trying to cross this chasm, if you will, but it is low impact. What is the big deal if their sneakers get a little bit wet? The second part of this image here in terms of low probability, low impact. Well, yeah, low probability, you can just step over that little pothole. And if you were to, maybe you would twist your ankle just a little bit, maybe get a little scrape, maybe dirty up your prized Jordan sneakers, right? Low probability, low impact, depending on who you talk to. But down below, we've got low probability, high impact. Very easy to jump over this little ledge here. But if you do make a misstep and slip, hey, you could come to serious injury. And of course, we've got high probability, high impact down here at the bottom. So why do we talk about this? And we'll circle it back to security here in just a moment. But we need to also understand that this is exactly what our senior leadership is thinking about every single day. Your boards of directors, your board members, your CEO, your CFO, your COO, all of the leaders of the various business units in your organization, they're asking themselves, if I make this decision, if I decide to cross the proverbial street, what are the chances that I'm going to get hit by a bus? And we need to understand that there are different types of enterprise risk. There is strategic risk. Does the organization want to undertake a certain business activity? I know some organizations that have purposely decided not to do business in China because they said, hey, from a business perspective, we don't want to take that strategic risk. So engaging in a certain activity or not engaging in a certain activity is a way to manage that element of your enterprise risk overall. Financial risk, of course. How much are we going to lend out? How much reserves do we want to carry? How much should we pay for a certain acquisition? Those are all financial related aspects. From an operational perspective, every single day when you're crossing again that proverbial street, you are making some decisions. Your business is making some decisions on whether or not something is risky or not. Compliance, regulatory requirements fall into there and under the general legal category as well. And then, of course, you've got reputational risk as well. Now, do you guys think that where does cybersecurity come into play of all of this? How come we don't list cybersecurity risk here? Do you think that it could cross-cut all of these, have an impact on all of these different elements? Absolutely. And that's exactly the type of thing that we need to be considering. Alan has an extremely excellent point that risk is also dependent on the size of the organization taking a risk, right? Do you think that a large financial institution like a JP Morgan Chase, when compared to a smaller organization, still in financial services like a small credit union, that they've got a much smaller portfolio, much smaller footprint that they're actually managing? So yeah, that definitely informs the impact portion and the probability portion of the risk equation that we were just talking about. So excellent point there, Alan. Now, let's break this down a little bit more. We already said that risk is probability times impact, but let's zoom in a little bit more. What does this mean for us in cybersecurity? What does this mean for us in security and therefore in security awareness? We commonly say risk is probability times impact, but it's very useful to break down the probability portion of the risk equation into two additional component parts. Vulnerability, what weaknesses, what misconfigurations, what issues do you have in your environment, times the threat. What are attackers? What are adversaries? What are threat groups actually doing? And it is a combination of those two things that inform the probability of risk to your organization overall. All right, very important to make that distinction. Now, security, so the cybersecurity industry, traditionally, historically, right, has largely focused on the vulnerability component of the risk equation. How do we fix vulnerabilities? How do we prevent vulnerabilities? How do we patch them and so on? And of course, though, in recent times, right, not so recent times, the threat component has become even more important. We've got frameworks, which we'll talk more about here in a little bit, like a MITRE attack, right, that has become the de facto standard for understanding what adversaries are actually doing. So there are good ways for us to understand and think about the probability here. But a lot of times we in security, we don't necessarily have a good understanding of the impact, right? What's the corresponding impact to our organizations? Here on the next slide, right? What is our overall goal? Our goal from a security perspective is to manage cyber risk. Now, how do we go about doing this? Well, we do this by reducing, managing, mitigating the probability of incidents. And remember, when we say probability, we are talking about a combination of both vulnerability and threat. So this is why we do things like we install our firewalls, we install intrusion detection prevention, we install endpoint detection and response, we take proactive controls to secure what we're doing on-premise and in the cloud. And now we factor in, well, what are the adversaries doing? What are we doing to detect them? What are we doing to detect real attacker adversary activity? So a lot of times we in security, we tend to focus on the how. What are the things that we do that we need to do on a day-to-day basis? Extremely important, right? Half of the overall risk equation. But the impact, this is the why. Why do we do certain things? And we do it because we want to reduce the impact of our very various security incidents. Now I see that David has a comment here that says, oh, yes, of course, risk is impact times probability. But hey, you've read about some unknowns, right? Like the black swan events that have occurred, right? Like the big financial crisis, 2008, 2009, like the one that we all have just recently lived through in terms of COVID-19. Now you might look back at that and say, hey, you know, that was actually predictable, right? We could have foreseen that. In fact, various governments around the world had made plans, right? Plans to say, hey, there's the likelihood of the impact of an outbreak, a global pandemic based on a new novel coronavirus, that would be pretty bad. However, a lot of organizations, a lot of countries, a lot of states around the world didn't heed that advice and take proactive measures. While they kind of had a sense, an understanding of the impact there, right? They didn't necessarily take into account, okay, well, how? What can we do today to mitigate the probability, the vulnerability, and the corresponding threat axes? So yeah, David, I think I would still kind of incorporate that into the way that we look at risk overall. So if we're talking about how do we go about managing cyber risk? Well, that's our ultimate goal. Now keep that, mentally bookmark that for just a moment in terms of managing cyber risk. I've got a friend, a mentor, Steve Katz, right? He's known as the world's first CISO. Maybe some of you guys know him as well. And I've heard him say this. He said this to me numerous times. He says, Frank, you know what? There are no security risks, right? It's not about cybersecurity. There are only business risks. And so I would definitely, right, what we're trying to talk about here and really hammer home is that we want to make sure that you guys understand that, hey, we need to take a step back, as many other presenters have said, and understand, well, how does this relate to the organization? How does this relate to the impact portion of the overall risk equation? Now, moving on to the next slide, going back to the how for a moment, how do we typically go about doing this? Well, this is an example security team org chart in a large organization. And this is, you know, still the majority of CISOs report up to the CIO. Now, that is changing, slowly changing, depending on the industry and depending on the company. Still, the vast majority of CISOs report within the technology organization. And you can see here in this example org chart that there are various functions, activities that every single security team does that actually tie back to that basic risk equation, doing things to manage and prevent and mitigate vulnerabilities, doing things to detect and analyze various threats. And well, there are certain things that we do to try to factor in the impact, right? Why do we do these things from a business perspective? Like governance, risk, and compliance, like appropriate program management, strategic planning, and so on. So Pauline has a perfect question here. She asks, hey, where would you position the security awareness program? Within information security, within IT compliance, within risk management? Now in this example org chart here, you can see where it is. And on this next slide, right, security awareness. Well, what is it? Security awareness is just another control, one of the many controls in the cybersecurity portfolio here to control and manage human risk. And ultimately, what is the goal of security awareness? Yeah, of course, it is to influence and change human behavior, right? Because by influencing and changing human behavior, we are turning the dials on that risk equation overall. So specifically, you know, yes, I've seen security awareness many times live within the information security team. And because of it being a key critical control, right, which is generally where I've had it on the teams that I've had in the past, but I have seen security awareness live in other areas, Pauline, as you're saying as well, whether that be in compliance, risk management, and so on. But there needs to be a strong relationship, in my opinion, to the information security team, like we see here. So the question then becomes, out of all of this stuff that you see here, all of the detailed things that need to be done by each of these teams, each of these boxes, how do we make a little bit more sense about it? You as a security leader, what do you need to do, right, to better frame, better structure the overall work of the security team? And what do you need to do, therefore, then, to better communicate and make decisions about what actually needs to be done? Well, this here on the next slide is where various cybersecurity frameworks come into play. Now, we're not going to go into all of the details of all of these frameworks. We don't have time for all of that, but I'm going to give a couple different examples here, right? We'll see a couple different examples momentarily. Now, we know that in that org chart that we just saw, there's a lot of stuff that the security team does on a daily basis. There's a proverbial alphabet soup of complex things that tend to be difficult for security people to explain. Lance mentions the curse of knowledge in another talk that is happening, right? And that's exactly what we're talking about here. You would think that security frameworks would be able to make the complex world of security a little bit more understandable. However, having read all of the details of these security frameworks, having unfortunately read all of the PDFs for the various things that we see here on the right-hand side of this slide, I can tell you firsthand that all of these frameworks, all of these documents don't make security less complex. It makes it even a little bit more complex. So how I like to think about this is, hey, there are three different types of security frameworks. Now let's draw an analogy here. Let's pretend that you want to be an amazing chef, but unfortunately, like me, some of you may have heard me talk about this before, unfortunately, like me, you're not a very good cook, but you have this dream, this vision to become a world-class chef one day. Well, the first thing that you need to do is you need to know what ingredients are available to you. What works well with each other, garlic and basil, right? Soy sauce and garlic and so on, whatever it might be. That list of ingredients is kind of like your control frameworks, right? What's every possible thing that you could put in the dish? Well, you know that you can't make a successful meal by including every single ingredient, just like you can't create a successful security program by including every single security control. That's not gonna work. So what do you do instead? You follow a recipe. And the recipe defines, hey, what amount, what measurement, how much should you actually put in? That is the equivalent of your program frameworks there, right? What activities provide the most bang for the buck? What works well together? What will people like to taste? But it's not just about creating a delicious dish. If you want to become a world-class chef, well, you're going to probably have to open up a world-class restaurant. To open up a world-class restaurant, you need to know, what do people value, right? What's the ambiance they're looking for? What's the vibe? Is it high-end? Is it, you know, accessible to more people, right? And you only know what people value, what the market values, what your stakeholders and your customers value, if you understand, getting back to that risk equation here, if you understand what the risk frameworks are, what is the combination of vulnerability, threat, and impact that you need to manage and present it in such a way that people will be able to understand, all right? So here on the next slide, how do you go about managing information risk or managing ultimately business risk? And I see Karen has this exact same question, is how do you go about discussing, right, the need for all of these security controls versus the impact, the convenience, the availability, all of those different trade-offs? This is where the security frameworks come into play. Right. At SANS over the years, SANS has done a lot of work talking to different board members, security leaders, and so on. And board members unanimously say, they say, look, we want you to give us some information related to industry standard frameworks and how we relate to others. How do we compare to our industry peers? And this is why you want to use these industry standard frameworks, because one, it provides you a third-party type of approach to structure your security program. It allows you to, two, communicate about that program in a consistent way. And number three, benchmark against other organizations. So if you are doing all of those things, you can then present that nice one-slide dashboard that says, hey, what's the comparison look like? And it's that type of thing that will inform your discussions with the business. Because remember, we said cyber risk. They say, hey, if we turn the dial a little bit more here, right, will that allow us to go and do business in China and open up more markets? If we don't want to take that risk, well, then could we turn the dial down so we don't have to spend and invest all of that money? Right? It all comes back to what the organization's mission actually is. Now, here on the next slide, let's go ahead and mention really quickly here some examples. This is an example of one of the control frameworks. We've got the CIS, Center for Internet Security Controls. Most recent version of this was just published a couple months ago or so, right? So I list this here as an example, because if you just glance at this bunch of words here, right, you'll have a sense that these are the types of things that your security teams in that larger org chart, they're doing these types of things on a regular basis. All right, now, here on the next slide, we've also got an example of your program frameworks. And if I could actually switch to the next slide, there we go. The one that we'll mention here is the NIST Cybersecurity Framework, CSF. Now, I mentioned this one as a program framework, the recipe here that you might want to follow because it is widely adopted, even internationally now, and it is well understood. Why do I think it is so well understood? Why do I suggest using that one? Because it is simple. check it out. On the left-hand side is the core of the CSF, which you've many of you have probably seen before. This models the life cycle of everything that every complex security team, every complex org chart actually does. We identify what we need to do. We identify our assets, our requirements. We protect, prevent bad things from happening. If something gets by our protective capabilities, we detect them, and then we respond to any of those things, and ultimately we recover. Now, David has a question here is, hey, where do you put side channel attacks in the control, program, or risk frameworks? Right, that's a very good question. And you might've seen this on that slide where I had the three. I mentioned MITRE ATT&CK verbally. MITRE ATT&CK was mentioned on that slide. I put MITRE ATT&CK in the risk framework category for me specifically, because remember, what did we say risk is? Risk is vulnerability times threat times impact. Where does threat go, right? Now, you could call MITRE ATT&CK a threat framework and whatever you might call it, right? But for us in our business conversation, that category falls under the risk umbrella right there, right? So that's how I would think about it. Because ultimately, remember, as Steve said, there are no security risks. There are only business risks here. Now, Tina has another excellent question that is related to what we see here on the slide is, what are we doing today? How are we doing? This comparison to your peer groups, and where do we want to go? Tina asks, well, where do you get information on benchmarking? Well, you can get information on benchmarking from some industry associations, groups that you might be a part of, like the ISACs, the Information Sharing and Analysis Centers, whether you're in financial services, the FSISAC, whether you're in healthcare, HISAC, whether you're in an educational institution, the RENISAC, for example. So definitely there's some information sharing that goes on. There's some limited amount of that type of data that is available publicly. But also, yes, Tina, truth be told, you know, where do you get that information? Generally, you've got to buy it from a consulting organization or from a research organization to get the most up-to-date data. All right. So Darren has another question here. Is there a framework for OT operational technology for ICS? Yeah, there is. There's also frameworks like the C2M2 that was originally created by the Department of Energy. Since that has since been made into a more broader framework that's applicable outside of just the kind of the energy and the industrial control sector as well. So there's a number of ones that are available. I'm only giving you kind of a taste of what the many different frameworks are that are available on the market are. All right, so now if we pause for a moment, let's take a step back, right? Hey, we've been talking about what is the basic risk equation. Right? Why is that important? How does that tie back to the impact, what the organization is trying to achieve overall, right? The why that we're doing these things. And then we talked about, okay, how do we as the security team, how do we move those things forward? We saw where security awareness was one key important control, but out of the many controls in the overall security portfolio. And then we associate that with the different frameworks that we can use to better understand what we're doing. So for you, the security professional, as you are progressing in your career, well, you want to improve, you want to get better, you want to make your organizations better. So how do we do that? Well, we found that, hey, to be a transformational security leader, to be an operational security executive, there are six key areas that you want to think about. One is technology, but not technology for technology's sake, technology for better managing information risk. The whole reason that we implement all of these controls, like awareness, is to better manage information risk. There is vulnerabilities, right? The corresponding vulnerabilities that come up, corresponding controls that could be implemented to manage in the lower right-hand corner from an operational perspective, building out your SOC, your response, your detection capabilities. But there's a couple other key elements in the lower left-hand corner, right? You've got strategy. And this is about aligning your security initiatives. All of the stuff that we saw on the org chart, you've got to make sure that those are aligned with your overall strategy, with your business goals. You've got to build a security plan that maps back to your overall business goals. You got to build a corresponding roadmap that will get you there. And oh, by the way, along the way, you've got to make sure that your team and your organization builds those in a sustainable fashion. You've got to lead change, build a self-sustaining culture that will enable all of these things to continue on long after you're gone. So just to kind of summarize, What should you do, right? Suggestion, next week, right? Go back to work. And if you don't know already, go back and talk to some of your friends in the security team and say, hey, how did we structure our work? How did we structure our program? What frameworks, what controls are we using in the organization? Within the next month, think about what your top human risks are and then map those back to the controls, right? And see where there's some gaps or where there aren't some gaps or where you've got coverage. And then with the next quarter and onward, go ahead and think about what are your awareness controls that will help you mitigate your overall business risks, right? So with that, I'm gonna go ahead and pause, close this out here. This was Understanding Cybersecurity Risk Management, really an introduction here to remind ourselves of some of these common concepts, how it applies to the security program overall, how it's related to awareness. And with that, I'm gonna turn it back over to Lance. If you guys have any questions, wanna stay in touch, feel free to reach out, connect with me on LinkedIn, shoot me a note whenever you like. Lance, back over to you.
All right, Frank. Hey, thank you so much. Just to follow up to Frank's point, first of all, I know sometimes this may not be the most riveting, but this is what makes the difference between just being in the entertainment business and being in the human risk business. So if you weren't sure about, please reach out to Frank. He's here to help you. We actually covered a lot of very serious concepts here in this overview. Now, Frank, there's one or two questions, but I just wanted to follow up with Pauline, who asked, you know, where should security awareness fall under? And I just wanted to follow up to Frank's point. You want to be sure it's aligned with and preferably under security. What we tend to find is if security awareness falls under human resources, compliance, or legal, it tends to take a very much compliance or legal focus. So you tend to be stuck in stage two compliance of the awareness program. Remember, we're very much focused on, we want to enable you to have an impact, change behavior, manage human risk. And to do that, the closer you are aligned with the security team, the more you're working with them, the better. That's why I was so excited to see Frank make that recommendation. Your very first step, go back to your security team and ask, hey, what frameworks are we using? What are our key controls? And how can I better align what I'm doing with those frameworks and controls? Because if you are aligned with your security team, you now get more credibility, visibility, and support because you're supporting the overall strategic mission of managing risk. Let's see here. Tina had a question, Frank. I'm not sure if you answered this one. Do you have any recommendations of peer groups or frameworks that focus on benchmarking cybersecurity risk? And I believe you did answer that one.
Yeah, we talked about that. But you know, now that you highlighted this, I see another kind of related question here from David, you know, related to talking about business risk, right? And the reason to benchmark, see how we're doing compared to others, and ultimately to manage our business risk. But you know, David also asks, hey, are there some weak signals in the frameworks or are there other tools? How do you understand what the business risk actually is? And this is one that I would recommend where, hey, you know, when you're going back and you're talking to your security team, what controls, what frameworks are using, in parallel, go back and set up some meetings with some people that are outside of IT, outside of security, some of the business unit leaders, and just try to get a better understanding of what the business is doing, how it makes money. If you're a publicly traded company, go ahead and download the quarterly reports. And there's a lot of information there in terms of how the business actually works, what the different business lines do. And because if you don't know about that stuff, how are you ever going to have a conversation with the CEO, the CFO, the COO? Because that's the stuff that they are thinking about on a daily basis.
All right, Frank, thanks so much. And folks, what Frank just did is he enabled you, he gave you the groundwork, the framework to speaking to leadership and the security team. And like I said, this is where we've seen from the past 10 years where our community, the security awareness community, tends to struggle the most. That interaction, that engagement, that communication training is key. But if you don't speak the language that Frank just covered, we're gonna continue to be fighting this battle to get support and to get credibility. So hey, Frank, once again, thank you so much. And then Frank, will you be able to answer questions in Slack?
Definitely, I'll see you guys here on Slack here momentarily.
All right, fantastic. Thank you so much, Frank.